take the data that already exists, because somebody has to, and it's 15 years since anybody last reviewed it, and then to try and go out and fill in the gaps in that data in order to tell a story. I would argue that that is an equally valuable contribution to going and studying two new sites in great detail that then will only tell you about those two sites and nothing else. So there's relatively little that has been, both that I physically have in front of me on the table, and even of those, many of them have previously been recorded by somebody else, and I've been checking them. There are, as I said, with the Eastern Baltic, there are a few sites on there where I and a local archaeologist, or a local zoo archaeologist, went and looked at a box of material which previously maybe had been sorted out as rodents. We have these rodents from the site, but nobody had studied in detail. And we've gone through and found, okay, actually we do have some rats here, but we don't. And the other point you could make is that what I haven't shown on the map are sites where we do not have rats present. Now that's obviously a problem because you need to decide what is a sufficiently intensively studied site. So one index you could use is, are mice present? Or you could use, are microfauna present? And that's something we're going to be trying to do in this northern study, working with my colleagues in different countries to try and get as much of the data as we can together on sites where we don't have rats present as well, so we can have a bit more confidence in what it means when there is a blank on the map. The difficulty there is, depending on the country, it can be harder or easier to do. So in England, that would be extremely difficult because there are many sites and the data is very fragmented. In the Netherlands, they have a central national database which doesn't have all the data, but which has all the sites listed and a list of which species are present and the reference, so you can then go and check them. So in the Netherlands, I can very easily come up with a list of every site that has Apodemus spatigolis present at it, and then go and check those reports. Okay, I can't check those reports easily because I don't have access to them, but my colleague in the Netherlands can go and check them. In Estonia, I can do that as well. In France, yes. In Germany, no. In Norway, yes. In Sweden, no. And so there's kind of quite patchy situations with the data. But when it comes to showing the evidence, I would argue that it would be impossible for any single team of people to do a study on this scale using only things that they have done themselves. There has to be a degree of trusting what's out there in the literature, based on a critical reading, based on knowing what the methods and what the expertise was like at the time that those publications were written, and based on where the data seemed to be questionable, going in and doing targeted studies, trying to check it. Does that answer your question?
Okay. As for zoologists, it's the most interesting question, how to differentiate both species. Mm-hmm. Is it quite easy question, or just it might be difficult for archaeologists rather than zoologists?
It depends who you ask. So based on the cranium, it's not a big problem at all. Based on the mandibles, it's not supposed to be a problem. However, there are cases where I've seen different people having a different opinion of it, which doesn't fill you with confidence. The big problem seems to be, so talking to my colleagues in Scandinavia, for example, one of the main sources is a German source for the relative osteological differences. And my Scandinavian colleagues tell me, well, we used to read that, we used to trust that source, but we've realized it doesn't work for Scandinavia. And so, again, when you're talking about two species, both of which adapt extremely fast, they reach sexual maturity in less than a year, they have very short generation times, they have anything like 90 to 95% infant mortality, so there's extremely high selection, they will adapt fast. And in that case, you wouldn't necessarily trust a morphological guide based on species in Spain to help you identify specimens in Finland. Which is why I'm trying to use ZooMS, so collagen fingerprinting, as far as possible, which will give us a definitive answer on that. Skulls are another matter, but for postcranial bones. People used to use size quite a lot, but we already know that archaeological black rats are often a lot larger than modern black rats, and again, that probably comes down to the effect of competition with brown rats. So you have some degree of niche partitioning that is resulting in black rats ending up being smaller. So there were some early finds which were identified as brown rat based on sheer size, which have since been reclassified as black rat when people realized that 1,000 years ago, European black rat were somewhat larger than modern black rat. So there are lots of problems over time and over space in Maybe I'm just too cautious. I don't know. Maybe I'm over skeptical. And maybe it's because I'm not a zoologist. I'm an archaeologist. But I'm a little bit cautious about definitive categorizations based on anthropological evidence and stuff, without the aid of molecular methods.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your exciting talk.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.